Okay. Art. Today we are going to talk about three things that I always think about when portrait painting and that I think you might find very helpful the next time you paint a portrait. The first thing is going to be about imagining an overall volume of the head. The second thing is going to be about using planes to orient yourself in space. And the third thing is going to be structural symmetry, or taking structures that exist on both sides of the face and relating them together so that you can really make your head sit in perspective and for things on either side of the face to agree. So the first thing was the large overall volume of the head. And imagining this in the background of your mind during the entire process is incredibly useful. Now, it really feeds into my process where you see me essentially finishing as I go or really focusing in on one area at a time because it helps me always keep in mind how everything should add up in the end to portray that large overall volume of the head and that light effect. But it also works just as well if you paint in a different way, if you paint in layers. Having this in mind will really bring everything together, keep the whole face tied together, and really help you understand and reinforce the goal of portraying that particular light effect. Now, if you're new to this idea, if you haven't done this before, I actually recommend you do it on a scrap piece of canvas. You could do it on the side of your canvas and paint your background over it eventually. But whatever it is you have to do to embed this in your mind, I recommend doing. Now, this also really connects to painting from your imagination. And in fact, anytime I've ever done a painting from imagination, I've literally painted out a generic version of the overall head with the light effect so that I can really visualize that and strategize and plan when painting that head from imagination. Now, to help you visualize this idea, let me illustrate it using a few different paintings. Now, if we take this painting, for example, this is me visualizing a large underlying volume of this head under this particular light source. The light comes in at this particular angle, strikes the form most directly here, and then that volume turns around away from that light source up to a shadow edge that would be approximately here. I can think of the generic average overall flesh tone, and I can use that to start modeling out of, and now that drops in value, it drops in chroma as it turns from the light up to that shadow edge, and then within the shadow, I can think about what the effect is, whether there's a reflected light, whether there's environmental light, whether there's some sort of secondary light or rim lighting, and all of that can be negotiated during this exercise and factored into this little study. And then that way, I can hold this as sort of a template for how the overall volume should add up in the end, what the light source should look like, and how I should balance out those various effects. Now here's this portrait and its underlying volume that I would picture in my mind as I work through the forms. And finally, this last portrait and its underlying volume that again I would hold in mind as I paint through it. Now, something you can do to sort of accessorize and make this exercise even more valuable is you can specifically lay out little color notes that anticipate the large color relationships on the particular portrait you're making. And you could even make little notations that remind you of what those mixtures were. So here you might be adding titanium white, cadmium orange, and raw umber. And then you might be taking those same colors, only adding more raw umber to lower the value and reduce the chroma. However, you might take note that the raw umber is lowering the chroma too much, so you have to add a little bit of cad orange back into it. When you get into the shadow, you might be mixing that raw umber with that cadmium orange, and perhaps you even need a little bit of alizarin crimson for that interreflected light. Now, this is going to vary depending on the flesh tones, the model, the scene, the lighting, but whatever it is, you can make little notes alongside of this exercise and even do these little color swatches, and that can give you a real framework for conceptualizing the color later on when it comes to the actual painting. Now, the second thing is thinking about large planes to help orient you in space. Now, one of the hardest things about this particular thing is that most of the forms on the face, if not all, are curved. You know, most of them are convex, some of them are concave, but you're always gradating to make a full, round, three-dimensional form. So it's kind of hard to fit planes into that. So the way I use it is to really transcend the picture plane or the flatness of my canvas and really get my mind into a position where it can accept how much parts of the head are turning in space. So I might look at a far side of a portrait and I think, okay, I have to paint this right now. If I think about it as form, I'm curving along, but that doesn't make me appreciate how much I might have to turn in space. As soon as I think about a plane like that, this is the plane. It's pointing out here in space. That really snaps my mind around to how far I have to travel in space. And there's a thing in 3D modeling and 3D software called the face normal. And that's essentially the sort of line or the pole that would stick out of each plane or facet of a 3D model. And sometimes I think about that, and I think about that pole sticking out of a particular plane, and then I relate that to me coming in, my line of sight, and I think, how much do I have to turn to align myself with that face normal or that pole sticking out of that plane? That's a little abstract. One other way, or a simpler way of thinking about it, is here's my picture plane, I'm coming in, how much do I have to turn my hand to make it parallel with that plane I'm trying to understand? And if I do that, I can usually transcend that space and put myself into a three-dimensional mode more effectively than if I'm just ambling along trying to follow a curve. So again, the cheek is a great way to visualize that. You look at the face, you sort of see your canvas, you see your picture plane looking in, and then you think, I have to rotate this much to touch this cheek. And as soon as you do that, that little switch flips and suddenly you're in that space, and you can do it anywhere. You can do it over here, over here, over here, over here, anywhere you need to. But those large planes and really feeling how they're oriented in space can really help you get around that large overall volume that we talked about previously. The third thing is structural symmetry. And that essentially means coordinating the two sides of the face together, or structures that exist symmetrically on the face. Now, that doesn't mean that you want to paint everybody perfectly symmetrical. In fact, part of the charm of portrait painting is looking for those little asymmetries, looking for those little differences that add more character. And I've talked about that before in other videos. Check out all my videos. I don't know which one it's in. But when you think this way, when you think about structural symmetry and you're always coordinating the two sides of the face, even if in that moment you're only painting one part of one side of the face, you can really discover issues and problems that you might otherwise not see in that moment. Now, there's one example that always comes to mind. Very often I'll be painting a three-quarter view of the head, or I'll be critiquing a painting of a three-quarter portrait, and I'll see a very specific, vivid contour of that far cheek. And then I'll look at the interior cheek and see how it's modeled. And the two things are not communicating the same kind of cheek or the same cheek shape. Again, somebody might have a certain amount of asymmetry, but in general, they should be close. So for example, I might see a contour that has a really high set cheekbone, it's really sharp, and then over here in the interior with the modeling, and of course this depends on the lighting, but I might see something that looks too large. The cheek, the apex of it, the most salient point of it is too low, and it feels like two different faces smooshed together into the same painting. And it's because the artists in that moment, as they negotiate that gradation here, or as they reshape this, they're not relating it conceptually to the other side. Now, this really applies to every single part of it. You could be doing one nostril and then the other, and they're kind of skewed, or one eye is too low, the other one's too high, or they're the different scale. You have to, in those moments that you're really focusing in on a particular part of the face, on a particular side of the face, be relating that to and coordinating it to its structural counterpart on the other side of the face. And again, that really applies to when you're doing a contour and an interior gradation. And that requires an extra level of complexity that you'll get to eventually. If this seems a little bit too challenging in the moment right now, depending on where you're at with your portrait painting, this is a layer of complexity that you'll get to, and you'll be able to fold into your process eventually. And that is seeing your gradation and your line, your contour line, as essentially representing the same thing. Thank you for checking out this video. If you like my content, make sure you hit that subscribe button. And if you want to support my channel, you can check me out at patreon.com/ScottWaddell. That helps me continue to make content like this, but it also gives you access to a ton of art instructional content, like hundreds and hundreds of hours of content over there, portrait painting series, still life series, drawing series, an academy series where I take you through exercises, just so much stuff. And another way you can support the channel is checking out my website, scottwaddellfineart.com. I have feature-length tutorials there with diagrams and concepts and other stuff. And you could also just check me out on social media and give some of my videos a like so I can feel good.